This video has been sponsored by PCBgogo. More on them later.
Hey everyone, I'm Zach Armstrong with LabCoatz, and today I'll be showing you how to build an extremely powerful Tesla coil that's not only reliable and efficient, but also super quiet, easy to build, and it fits in the palm of your hand.
I've done a lot of work with Tesla coils on this channel, and one of the main things I like to try to think about is how to optimize my setups to get the best possible performance. Now, if you're new to Tesla coiling, you may be tempted to just throw some bigger, more powerful components into your circuit and hope for the best, but this approach will only get you so far. Believe me, I've tried. In reality, there are several factors that contribute to a Tesla coil's behavior. So let's take a look at what they are and see if we can come up with a high-performance design that isn't too complicated or expensive. The first thing to look at is the driver type, of which there are three main varieties: spark gap, vacuum tube, and solid state. Solid state is by far the most efficient, readily available, and cheap topology, so we'll be going with that. Solid state circuits tend to come in three main sub-varieties: single transistor, half bridge inverter, and full bridge inverter. Single transistor Tesla coils are like the one I built in my first video, and they can have pretty good performance, but I think we can do better. A full bridge is typically viewed as the best setup, but it has four transistors, which makes it quite expensive. And since the performance isn't that much better than a half bridge, I'll be going with a half bridge inverter for this Tesla coil. Now, regardless of the transistor arrangement, all solid-state Tesla coils work in a fairly similar way. A signal that matches the resonant frequency is obtained from either feedback or a separate oscillator, and is then amplified and used to switch a transistor or transistor array at the same frequency. The transistors then do their thing and switch a much larger DC voltage across the primary coil at the desired frequency, which causes an alternating magnetic field to be created that drives the secondary coil to produce incredibly high voltages. If you want a better idea of what one of these circuits could look like, check out my last video on solid-state Tesla coils, which I've linked to in the cards and video description. The main drawback of solid-state Tesla coils like the one I made recently is that their current is limited by the primary coil. The primary coil has a certain inductance, and that inductance causes a kind of resistance specific to AC signals, known as reactance. Fortunately, there is a trick to eliminate this unwanted reactance, and that is to add a capacitor of specific size in series with the inductor. If the capacitor-inductor combination has a resonant frequency matching the frequency being applied to it, the reactances cancel, leaving only the very small resistance of the wire itself. This is, in fact, the main principle behind dual resonance in a DRSSTC. The goal is to have the primary circuit tuned so that its reactance is near zero, which allows the resonant signals produced by the solid-state circuitry to flow unimpeded at very high currents. Higher currents result in higher secondary voltages, and you can probably guess the rest.
So, great! We know DRSSTCs are super powerful and efficient, so all we need to do is throw a resonant-sized capacitor or circuit and go, right? Well, like most things, it's not actually that simple. In reality, there are a few key modifications we need to make to our circuit, so it's more suited for dual resonant operation.
To start, we'll be adding a circuit component known as a flip-flop to the driver circuit. This doesn't make the sparks any longer, but does prevent the interrupter from shutting off your transistors while current is flowing, which could kill them if you're running in dual resonance. For best results of the flip-flop, it's best to use primary feedback in the driver circuit instead of secondary or antenna feedback. If you do go with primary feedback though, you'll need your primary circuit to be tuned fairly precisely, otherwise your circuit will behave rather poorly. In this circuit, I'm actually choosing to stick with antenna feedback, just because I'm used to it and it's easy to set up. However, using secondary feedback like this makes running in dual resonance somewhat more dangerous to the transistors, since the phasing of the secondary coil will be slightly off and the flip-flop won't be perfectly timing the transistor switching. Therefore, I won't be tuning my primary circuit to perfect dual resonance. Fortunately, ultra-precise tuning isn't required with secondary feedback, so I'll just be roughly tuning my circuit to near resonance, which will allow the impedance to be low, but not low enough to cause overcurrent issues or harmful voltage spikes. I'll also be using two 1.5K220CA TVS diodes in series across each of my IGBT collector and emitter pins to help stop voltage transients that could potentially damage the transistors.
Alright, now that we've configured our SSTC as a DRSSTC, it's time to think about other ways to make the sparks even larger. Now, the first thing that comes to my mind is QCW. QCW stands for quasi-continuous waveform, which is basically a way of powering a solid-state Tesla coil that results in super long sword sparks.
In a traditional QCW circuit, an Arduino or similar microcontroller will chop up the power going to the Tesla coil with an IGBT or MOSFET driven at PWM frequencies. The PWM signal will gradually increase the pulse width during the pulse to create an average voltage that rises linearly from zero to the full input voltage within 10 to 20 milliseconds. A large inductor and filter capacitor are then used to clean up the current going to the Tesla coil, and the result is a nice clean voltage ramp that leads to the wonderfully long arcs found in QCW Tesla coils. The only problem is, I don't want to have to deal with designing, building, and programming a QCW ramping circuit for my DRSSTC. So what do? Simple. We take the easy way out. QCW is actually developed from an older interrupting technology used in vacuum tube Tesla coils, called staccato. The staccato circuit is much easier to build and actually uses the AC waveform of common wall sockets to make a unique sinusoidal ramp that is perfect for driving our circuit. The staccato circuit also features potentiometers for adjusting the pulse rate and on times. Now, since we are basically designing a QCW DRSSTC, we should probably look at how to optimize such circuits. The Low Notions website is by far the best resource for this kind of information, and it actually has several pages dedicated to DRSSTCs and QCW. I highly encourage you to go check it out for yourself, but this is what I came away with. First, it's best to go with a small coil with a resonant frequency above 300 kHz. Below 300 kHz, the sparks tend to be more branched like a traditional Tesla coil, but above 300 kHz, sparks are usually more straight and sword-like. It's probably also best to stay below 600 kHz, not only for the circuit's sake, but also because the sparks at this frequency tend to become more curvy instead of purely straight. This is mostly my preference though, since I'm trying to get the longest, straightest sparks possible. Next, a larger top load is typically better because it helps stabilize the resonant frequency, which dips some when long sparks form. Since our circuit is running on antenna feedback and detuning is not much of a problem, this is less important. Still, larger top loads do tend to allow higher voltages to develop before spark breakout is achieved, so I'll be using a decently sized 6.5-inch top load for my Tesla coil. Finally, our primary circuit should be designed with a higher primary impedance and coupling. In spark-up Tesla coils and normal DRSSTCs, we want a smaller primary coil, bigger capacitor, and a lower coupling. But for a QCW Tesla coil, we want a larger primary with a tighter coupling and less series capacitance. For my coil with a resonant frequency near 350 kHz, 5 turns or so seems to work best, along with a 2 kV 80 nanofarad resonant capacitor bank. I tried fewer turns, but the output was less stable, and I blew up a few IGBTs along the way. I encourage experimentation with the tuning and coil layout, but be sure to have a few extra transistors or TVS diodes ready just in case you burn something out.
Alright, we now have a basic idea of what we want our circuit to look like. And while I'd like to take credit for the designs I'm about to show you, I really can't, because it's basically just another modified Low Notions circuit.
In 2014, Low Notions released this circuit, the RSSTC, or Ramped Solid State Tesla Coil. It's essentially everything we're looking for. It's a half-bridge Tesla coil with a staccato interrupter for ramped sparks and a flip-flop for stable dual resonance. There are a few main differences between our circuits, however. Namely, mine has antenna feedback, fewer unnecessary components, and more protective components. Mine has also been tuned closer to dual resonance. In the end, this is what my circuit looks like. Understandably, this may look a bit intimidating to some people. I know that I wouldn't want to try to build this on a blank breadboard. Fortunately, I didn't have to, and neither do you. I custom designed this PCB for my circuit, which you can download the files and instructions for below in the video description, and had a few copies printed by this video's sponsor, PCBgogo. PCBgogo is a highly specialized PCB manufacturing company that specializes in quick turn PCB prototypes and assembly, as well as small to medium volume PCB production. You can see the PCBs that I received here, and I think they turned out pretty well. They also shipped out pretty fast, and I received them within a few weeks of ordering. In the past, I've used companies like JLC PCB to order my PCBs, and I'd say PCBgogo presents a fair match to its competitors. If you ever need PCBs manufactured in any quantity, be sure to check them out at PCBgogo.com. Their customer service is also quite remarkable, take it from me. Also, if you order from PCBgogo right now, you could get your first qualifying order sent to you as a free trial order, and the only thing you have to pay for is shipping. Check out the links below for more details. And now, with the pre-designed PCBs in hand, it's time to put the circuit together and see what it's capable of.
right, in my mind, this is the best solid-state Tesla coil that I've ever built. It's quiet, compact, efficient, and produces ridiculously long sparks.
Over 20 inches to be precise, and from a tiny 5-inch coil, which means the sparks are over 4 times the coil's length. Performance like this is not usually so easy to obtain, but I was able to do it over a weekend with this setup. The new circuit also doesn't have any large bus capacitors like most other solid-state and dual-resonant Tesla coils, which cuts down cost quite a bit. As an added bonus, the ramped sparks produced by the circuit are remarkably quiet, despite their length. This, coupled with the coil's almost palm-top size, makes it a great fit for an indoor Tesla coil. The peak power on the circuit is also pretty insane. Using a super low-value shunt resistor and my oscilloscope, I calculated my circuit's average peak current to be around 50 amps or so. And with a peak voltage near 350 volts, this means the system's peak instantaneous power draw is over 15 kilowatts. Now that is insane.
Now before you go, I'll actually be giving away 2 PCBs to the next people to donate or support my work on Patreon. Any money that I earn will be going to building this channel up and creating better content overall. The links are down below.
If you like extreme science, cool projects, and ridiculous chemistry, make sure you're subscribed to my channel. Trust me, I've got quite a few videos lined up in the coming year that you don't want to miss. And if you have any ideas for future videos, drop them in the comment section down below. I read all of my comments and try to respond to as many questions as possible. A special thanks goes out to my patrons and all the people who support me and my work. Make sure to like, share, and subscribe, and I'll catch you next time. LabCoatz out.